Good morning. We're going to continue talking about mannerism today, and I'd just like to pause to discuss the idea of mannerism. It's a relatively new concept. Throughout the time that mannerism was being practiced, and for, let's say, well into the 20th century, mannerism was simply considered to be part of the Renaissance. In fact, for quite a long time, let's say until the 19th century, late 19th century, Baroque was considered to be part of the Renaissance. People really didn't make distinctions. You could tell the difference between Gothic and classical, but parsing out the difference between different ways of using the classical language was not so easy. So if something like Farnese Palace or the Tempietto counted as really good Renaissance because of the ideality of the form or the perfection of the proportions or the use of ideal geometrical figures like the circle and the square, then everything that didn't do that didn't need a name like mannerism or Baroque. There was a perfectly good word ready to use to describe this stuff, and that word was bad. You would look at something mannerist and you would say, this guy is out of control. You would look at somebody who had really different ambitions, different ideas about what architecture could do, but if you have the wrong frame in which to situate an argument, you won't draw the right conclusions. So really, it really wasn't until, like, say, the 1960s that a man called Arnold Hauser wrote a book called Mannerism. And this book began to say, no, these are not examples of a really poorly deployed Renaissance series of objectives. In fact, something really different is going on. And the different stuff that is going on is aimed at really different objectives. This is Frederick Hart, an art historian who wrote one of these definitive 500-page histories of Italian art. And he says, whereas the content of the high Renaissance art is often ideal, mannerist art often chooses subjects that are abnormal or unnatural, and the strange and unexpected aspect of a subject may be emphasized. Mannerist interpretations sometimes stress uncontrolled emotion or withdrawal. In high Renaissance art, the narrative will usually be direct, compact, and comprehensible. In mannerist art, it is often elaborate, involved, and obtuse. So while space in high Renaissance will be measured, harmonious, and ideal, manner space can be disjointed, spasmodic, and or limited to the foreground plane. High Renaissance compositions are harmonious and integrated, they're often centralized, and they may assume a pyramidal or conical form. For example, ideal centralized churches like Santa Maria della Consolazione. Mannerist compositions may be conflicting, and the forms often seek to frame or violate it. While high Renaissance proportions are normative and idealized, mannerist proportions can be uncanonical and usually attenuated. So Hart is picking up on what Arnold Hauser had noticed, that there are these differences. And while the Renaissance named themselves, they thought this idea of rebirth, those who recovered classics and recovered culture after 1,000 years of darkness would be a good name for themselves. The name mannerism was really placed on them like so many other names. These are two books that are important in thinking about how mannerism operates. The first is from Literary Criticism called Seven Types of Ambiguity by William Empson. And the second you're probably familiar with. It's really an important 20th century book, Complexity and Contradiction by Robert Venturi. And both of these books make an argument in favor of the complex, in favor of ideas that are not singular but multiple, in favor of things that resonate with a lot of different nuances and layers of meaning. And both suggest that the complexity, the richness, the density of meaning makes this actually better and more valuable to study than something that is too singular in its sense. And here's Hauser's little book on mannerism. Let's look at a couple of compositions to see how this notion about mannerism plays out. On the left is Raphael, the Madonna of the Fish. Because I just want you to notice that here's a fish. And you don't see that every day in an enthroned Madonna painting. It's the Madonna of the Fish. And of course, the fish is a symbol of Christ. So it's not just that this person thought that the Madonna would like to have a fish. But these are both basically the same theme. Here we have Parmigianino, Madonna of the Long Neck, and Raphael, Madonna of the Fish. And the Raphael composition is like other Raphael compositions that we've seen before, like Madonna del Prato, or pretty much like any Renaissance composition we've seen before. That is to say, Raphael does this very nicely with this little perspectival stuff. There's a vanishing point that converges to a center line. Two-dimensionally, there is this beautiful triangle that organizes all the figures. Truly couldn't be more balanced. Truly couldn't be more perfect. There's even this kind of nice play of rich, saturated colors like red and blue. Then you look at the Parmigianino and you think, well, that's a well-named picture, just as Madonna of the Fish is well-named because there's a fish in the picture. But here, Madonna of the Long Neck does not simply have a long neck. She also has a long baby, and she also has pointy feet. I mean, it's as though she had been stretched. It's as though all these figures have been attenuated, pulled, stretched, and not only stretched, but denied any space into which their actions can be situated. I mean, if Raphael is all about making this little proscenium that his holy family can be organized around, this Madonna and her child seem to be not even seated on the throne, but pulling forward, smashing against the picture plane. And Parmigianino does everything to exaggerate this. For example, look at the little baby down here, or look at this miniature person. What is the deal with that? We saw this in the Michelangelo Donitondo also, this radical juxtaposition in scales between people who are close to us and people who are far away. This incredibly deep space is being suggested, or there is a similar theme to the Donitondo, that this represents the new order, and this represents the old order. And the transformation from the age of pagan antiquity to the age of Christianity is happening at such accelerated pace that little pagan guy gets left behind with his broken column that also could represent the overturning of the old order and the institution of a new order. The subject is the same. The handling of paint is the same. But the space is really different, and the idea about the figure is really different, and you might say the density of meaning is really different. In the Raphael, we have the big symbol of the fish going on. Way to go, Raphael. For the rest of it, it's pretty straightforward. It is pretty much all about the Holy Family. But in the Parmigianino, meaning upon meaning upon meaning have been compressed together, and it becomes an archaeological task to dig through the meanings to figure out what the painting is about. Here's another example, comparing Leonardo's Last Supper, which is fabulous, and a really good example of a high Renaissance sensibility. We looked at this before, and we saw how the painting divides in half along the heads of the people dining. We have the lower range of life on earth. We have the upper range of this vault of heaven, or simply evacuated space. Christ's head is in the middle, and the perspective lines converge on Christ's head. So everything about the construction of the painting and everything about the space of the painting seems to be establishing the same kind of objectives that Raphael was after. Look over here at the Tintoretto. Tintoretto is a Venetian painter and quite an oddball, really, in his way of painting. I oscillate in my life between loving him and hating him, and I've been loving him for the last 10 years. The things about him that I hate you can't see because the slides are too washed out. But he has this sloppy handling of paint. It's not sloppy like, say, Titian is sloppy or Rubens is sloppy where they're totally in control or Rembrandt is sloppy, but he's really sloppy. And you get a sense that he's got 25 people working for him. And he's got the guy painting the hands and the guy painting the noses and the guy painting the feet. And they don't always collaborate. So these big workshop paintings, which could be as big as this wall over here, sometimes don't hang together very well. But clearly is in control of the composition. And the compositions are really quite amazing. Like if the Leonardo divides in half in this very decorous way, enforcing the ideality of geometry and celebrating this square and circle which frame the Christ, here we have a diagonal, this radical diagonal recession. And we have a juxtaposition of quite different worlds. The Last Supper on one side of the diagonal and people washing dishes with their cat on the other side of the diagonal. It is really stuff that you shouldn't see in a picture of something like the Last Supper. It's been brought down to earth. There's a radical collision between members participating in this painting, between the very holy, glowing, sainted figures on the far end and these ordinary figures. And you get the same kind of thing here with this dark group of angels swooping down from above. They keep getting weirder. You can look at these mannerist things forever, because everything that we've been appreciating and learning to love and learning to respect in the Renaissance paintings seems to be undermined, but undermined deliberately. It's not. It's clearly not that people like Bronzino here or people like Tintoretto over there were just not good enough to get the Renaissance space down. Clearly, they didn't want to get the Renaissance space down. They were after other things. They were after other relationships. So these are two paintings, two allegorical paintings. We have The Birth of Venus by Botticelli that we've looked at before. And here is Bronzino's Allegory of Love. A lot of it has to do with how clear the subject is in the Botticelli. It is all about the thing in the center. And the thing in the center is Venus. Venus on her little half shell, her shell representing a kind of virgin birth, and therefore making clear that the Venus allegorically refers to the virgin. Fabulous. We divide the canvas in half. We situate something in the middle. We've carved out a space for all of this action to happen. And look what's happening in the Bronzino. It's like a tangle of people. It's like they've deliberately gone out of their way to twist limbs together to make almost a brocaded, knotted fabric pushed up against the picture plane. Plus, not a bit clear what the action is. Not even so clear who owns which arms and legs. Like, whose hand is this? Whose butt is this? Whose arm is this? It's unknowable. And why you need all these people in here is also sort of mysterious and unknowable. And if this is allegory of love, let's say maybe Venus, maybe Cupid, but who else are these people? Who is this big man over here with a shiny bald head? And if you want to just be horrified and think for a moment who that man might be, look at the Donitondo for a moment. And look at the types of the Donitondo, this Michelangelo painting that we looked at last time. The Donitondo has an elaborate cast of characters. We have the Virgin, we have Joseph, we have the child, we have ambiguous guy here who oscillates between being Saint John, the devil, and Cupid. And we have a bunch of people here that we pretty much say must represent pagan antiquity because they have these grape leaves in their hair. So if you compare the Bronzino to the Michelangelo, you almost see the same figures getting redeployed in different actions across the canvas. I find this to be so alarming. Because when we looked at the Donitondo, we said, this is a bizarre pose. The posture of the Virgin, this heaving something over her head, is not something you see every day. But you see it again in the Bronzino. You see the bald man hovering above the Virgin in an embracing, protective way here. Here you see the bald man, I don't know, in the act of violating someone or something. And strangest of all is this reinterpretation, let's say, of what the little children do, where it's as though the baby crawls down from the arms and begins to molest the woman. So I don't know. I mean, Bronzino is a Florentine. Michelangelo is a Florentine. The Doni are rich people. I don't know if the Donitondo got widely displayed. It could have been something they just had in their house. But it's still kind of alarming. And Bronzino does this all the time. Here's another Bronzino where he's making a kind of a riff on his own painting, where he has this strange act of bosom love going on between butt boy, or else the other guy, and the woman. And here he simply recasts figures, that child and other child become interested in each other's bosoms. What can I say? It's so odd. So that's mannerism. That's mannerist language. And it happens as strangely in architecture as it happens in painting. And a lot of it has to do with the fact that the iconological programs are getting more and more complex. And by iconological, I mean the set of symbols going into it. For some of these buildings, you would get learned cardinals writing, you know, two-volume iconological program briefs and saying, this is what we want to symbolize, this is how we have to symbolize it, you know, the moon means this, this is the astrological chart, you've got to get that in there. And the artists have this burden of loading up the symbolism, and off they go. And of course, if you have to mean a lot of things, a good way to express meaning is to use language. So architecture becomes increasingly linguistic. And by linguistic, I just don't mean the kind of language of architecture that we saw in classicism, where there's a syntax. And by syntax, I mean the method of composing the pieces correctly. And by vocabulary, I mean the pieces. For example, column.
entablature, pediment, triglyph. These are all parts of a vocabulary that can be put together according to a grammar and a syntax to make a meaningful construction, like temple.
Rhetorical tropes are figures of speech. You're probably familiar with some figures of speech like metaphors and similes. Like, your eyes are like the moon, or other things like that. Or things like repetition, where you say something again and again. Jesse Jackson has great rhetorical style. It's too bad we don't hear him speak more. But if you would listen to him give speeches, there was one famous one where he said something like, from the poorhouse, to the workhouse, to the governor house, to the White House. And that's an example of repetition, where the argument becomes amplified by pushing it forward and each time shifting the terms a little bit. And so if you look at some of this mannerist stuff, you begin to see rhetorical tropes exploding. I was just looking at a list of rhetorical tropes, and all of them seemed appropriate. I was putting some of them down, and it just seemed like, why bother? They all seem appropriate, because there is some tweaking of the language toward rhetorical exaggeration of meaning that happens again and again. And we already saw that going on in Michelangelo's Laurentian Library at San Lorenzo, where there was this juxtaposition between tall and long, or between incredibly crowded and incredibly evacuated. And even some of these rhetorical tropes like repetition, we see the same figure again, or the denial of one condition with another condition, in the way Michelangelo situated the columns and the walls in the same plane, so as to suggest the sameness of both, or the impossibility of either to do the task at hand. When Michelangelo does the Porta Pia in Rome, this is really quite late in Michelangelo's work, it's around 1560, in many ways his task is simple, build a gate to the fortified wall of Rome. And there are certainly precedents that abound for something like that. This is just one of the many arches in the Roman Forum, the Arch of Septimus Severus. So if Michelangelo weren't such a screwy guy, he might have done something like this. But of course Michelangelo wouldn't dream of doing something like that when he could do something like this. And what is something like this? This is a gate. This is not so different from the Arch of Septimus Severus, except that instead of being singular and unified and focused, it seems to be multiple and exaggerated. It seems to present itself not so much as a thing, but as a billboard or a sign of a thing. It's probably very effective, right? You're walking down the road. This is the eastern gate to Rome. You want to come into Rome. And from long away, you see this because it's like a tower. It's so high up. But it's also making a gate and then making a gate again. It's this doubling. It's this repetition. It's the Jesse Jackson from the workhouse to the governor house to the White House going on here as the same thing gets reiterated and reiterated and reiterated. There's also a weird attitude toward architectural language. We said that good syntax puts the pieces of a language together in a clear and readable way. The cat is black, not black is cat the. One of them makes a sentence and the other one is just a bunch of words. So if syntax in architecture would say pediment, entablature, columns all worked out that way, what is Michelangelo doing down here? He's giving us the pieces we want to have, but he's not letting them cohere. He's not simply giving us the pieces that we want to have, but he's doubling or quadrupling the pieces that we want to have. Like, let's look at this central portal over here. What is it that makes the opening? We've talked about different things that can make openings. We've said, well, you could have a lintel, you can have an arch, you can have a pediment. In the case of Michelangelo, we have all of them. We have a lintel, we have an arch, we have another arch, we have another arch, we have a pediment, we have another pediment. It is this like superposition of multiple iterations of the same figure, all of which transform and all of which are in some way critical of the other figures that are going on there. Like even this pediment, in a sense, splits apart as though the idea of center that seems to be the big theme being reiterated here, even that can't hang together. And the center splits apart and is only tethered together by this little festoon, this little carved piece of ornament. Crazy. And things transform. They start off as one thing and they become another thing. Porta Pia is Michelangelo at his craziest. This is Michelangelo when he's carving that Rondanini Pietà, the one that looked like it was Gothic. He had hacked away so much material from it. So this is him really running with the most extreme presentation of what architecture can do. Like, look what's happening over here. What are these little ears doing on the side? In a sense, it looks like they want to be brackets, or they want to be Ionic column capitals that have folded down in the wrong direction. And the same kind of thing happens here. Michelangelo loves the ear. He loves taking something that seems to be all about a square and making it specific, flaring it out to make it kind of look like a column capital, slipping it down to begin to suggest that in spite of the ideality of the square, things can't hold. And what's this? What's this piece over here? Well, it's round, must be perfect. We love those circles, we can't get enough of them. But is this just a droopy column that's like a towel hanging over a circle? Has he just begun to play around with the idea of architectural language to suggest ways that it could work, perfect pilaster, fluted, great, and ways that it can't work, and putting them together in such radical juxtaposition, you have no idea what's going on? Or look at this, keystone. I couldn't be happier. It's exactly where I want it. It's right in the middle of whatever this thing is. If it were in the middle of an arch, kind of is, this octagonal arch, great. Of course, there's a super redundancy of keystone, from keystone to little head, to keystone on top of little head, to big plaque, all of which seem to serve as keystone. And if you didn't get enough keystones, look down here underneath this perfectly ideal pilaster. What do we get on the column capital or the pilaster capital? We get a baby keystone. He's out of control, but he's Michelangelo. There's no stopping him. So look at that, baby keystone. Crazy. Sadly, if you walk around to the back of the Porta Pia, you don't see much because it is an 18th century facade. But if you look at any piece of language on this thing, it seems to take your expectations and subvert them. Here, for example, Ionic column capitals. Delightful, but just like frosting on a cupcake, not like anything that is working syntactically like a column capital is supposed to work. Best thing ever, Michelangelo. In a more low-key way, you could say that the Palazzo Massimo that we looked at before is playing a lot of the same kinds of games. For example, on the front, it proposes itself as an ideal Renaissance palazzo, and yet it bends. It distorts its ideality to conform to the bend of the street. It's also incredibly ambiguous about how many stories are here. You don't get to read it very clearly. You see a bunch of little punches that don't quite seem big enough to organize a wall or a room. And when you get to the interior of the Palazzo Massimo, the space of the system becomes clarified. Another kind of device that you see frequently in Mannerist architecture kind of reminds me of that Bronzino allegory of love, not in its creepy subject matter, but in the idea of density, in the idea of accretion of tangled ornament or pattern making on a surface. And this is the Palazzo Spada in Rome. Not really important in and of itself, but there's a very important piece of Baroque architecture stuck inside of it, the Galleria Spada by Borromini, that we'll look at in a couple of days, probably. We're going fast. But you can see that this whole surface is encrusted with a kind of ornamental pattern. Mannerism really finds its best subject matter not in the palazzo, not in urban architecture, but in garden architecture. And I think that's because garden architecture, at the very point of departure, suggests contrast, suggests the putting together of two possibly irreconcilable conditions, architecture with geometry, with culture, with the shaping of space, and nature with its fecundity and its growth and its uncontrollable vigor. And how do these two things come together? What wins? Is it nature? Is it culture? And Bramante's Belvedere is really the first example of an effort to make some kind of garden space. And we looked at it before, and we suggested that in many ways it picks up from Roman precedents, things like the framed space, like a forum, but also things like verbal descriptions of gardens that Pliny or other classical figures would have had. Even more explicitly, things like the Templo Fortuna Primigenia, Republican Roman temple on the outskirts of Rome. And some of the themes that are going on in the Belvedere are themes that become very dear to the hearts of further garden makers. You know, this is the text against which all subsequent gardens refer when they make their little distortions. So certainly one thing that's going on is the idea that architecture is a frame. Architecture becomes a frame that repositions nature and begins to allow nature to operate in very specific ways. The idea of the ground plane is also really important. And as you move from low ground to high ground to higher ground, you're either closer to the earth or you're closer to heaven. And therefore, your condition in the world changes. You either become immersed in the land, or you become liberated into the sky, or some gardens work in the opposite direction. You start out in the city and you find yourself in the dark forest, lost and confused. Another thing that's going on in the Belvedere that you see again and again in these subsequent Mannerist gardens is the instability of the center. The idea that a garden is supposed to be an ideal four-square paradise garden. Why can't it just be that? And it's not. There is a kind of suggestion of a center and then a displacement of the center. A suggestion of the center and then a displacement of the center. So it's a game of constantly repositioning yourself and recentering yourself along the line as you move through the space. You finally come to this area right over here where the center is incredibly unstable. It's this Bramante stair, which moves you up, puts you on a center, and then switches from concave to convex, and you find yourself moving up in a very different way. Villa Madama, in many ways, is the first attempt to take stock of the lessons of the Belvedere courtyard. And it does it really in a kind of similar way. If Belvedere had this transformation along a line from space up to space up to space, bracketing it with architectural constructs, the papal apartments, and the Belvedere Villa, then Villa Madama proposes to do the same kind of thing, but using the architecture as a middle point that begins to transform your experience. The architecture becomes a kind of filter between different realms. Here we are in a bounded, somewhat urban courtyard, like a little forum or like a little cortile. And we pop through, we're in this rotunda piece, and then suddenly we find ourselves out in a garden, in a garden that proposes itself kind of as an ideal four-square paradise garden, but one that's been attenuated, one that's moving on out. And the proportions of the urban or urbane courtyard and the landscape garden are similar. We also noticed that Raphael died before the Villa Madama was completed, leaving it in this provocative state of incompletion. And when I say provocative state of incompletion, I mean, if this reconstruction represents Raphael's idea, it's a balanced thing. It's a Renaissance thing. It's got the center line. It's got the dividing line. Things organize into a perfect triangle. It could be a Raphael Madonna. But in this configuration, it's pulling apart. You have the hemicycle going one way. You have the loggia going the other way. And there's almost nothing in between them. This aerial perspective, I think, shows you the power of how this thing is locked into its landscape with these. It's like a truck pull, I don't know, or what do we have? Tug of war, where the axis coming out of the hemicycle moves in one direction, the axis coming out of the garden moves in the other direction, and the building just tugs. So much so that the landscape fractures, and you get this big sectional change at the point where the villa engages this wall, moving you down, flattening the space in a fairly radical way. We also notice that Raphael is using this strange material in the Villa Madama, this pinkish tufa, to become explicit about the fact that this is a country house instead of an urban house. You might say this is a little bit more linguistic than it needs to be also. He's assigning meaning to material. He's assigning meaning to rustication, but he's even assigning meaning to the kind of stone he's using. Painting the Vatican Stanze, the School of Athens, the Fire in the Borgo, the series of lunette paintings that Raphael managed, there was a whole workshop of people. Peruzzi was one of the people working on that. And also Giulio Romano was another painter who was good friends with Raphael and who was working on that too. When we spoke last time about the decorative program in the Villa Madama, we said that this patterned, we call it grotesque, meaning as if in a grotto, that little swirly pattern stuff that Raphael used in the loggia of the Villa Madama, came from a Roman villa that he and Giulio Romano fell into when they were off walking around the Roman Forum and sketching. So they were good friends. But unfortunately, Giulio Romano had to leave Rome. And the reason Giulio Romano had to leave Rome is that it was the seat of the papacy, and Giulio Romano was a pornographer. You can find the book at the Fine Arts Library. They keep it behind the desk. And so the thing to do is to ask for a whole bunch of Renaissance books and to stick this one in there so they don't think you're just looking at their dirty pictures. If you want to write it down, it's called E. Moldi, I-M-O-D-I. And it's full of stuff like this. I go very quickly through Giulio Romano's pornography because he was thrown out of Rome for it. So he went north. He went up to the town of Mantua where there was a bachelor duke, Mr. Gonzaga. And Mr. Gonzaga said, yeah, you can come here. This would be fine. Welcome to my court. This is a painting of Giulio Romano by the great Venetian painter Titian, who was also his friend. And it seems like in the north, pornography was fine. This is a famous painting by Titian called Venus of Urbino. This was done for the court of Urbino. It's a beautiful painting. Art historians love it. You look at this thing and you say, this really exemplifies the Renaissance nude, this kind of reclining nude. But this is what Mark Twain thought when he wrote Tramp Abroad. And this is a great book. If you ever want to travel in Europe, you should just bring your little Tramp Abroad with you, because Mark Twain is funny. And he says, you enter the Uffizi and proceed to that most visited little gallery that exists in the world, the Tribune. And there, against the wall, without obstructing wrap or leaf, you may look your fill upon the foulest, the vilest, the obscenest picture the world possesses, Titian's Venus. It isn't that she's naked and stretched out on a bed. Oh, no. It is the attitude of one of her arms and hand. If I ventured to describe that attitude, there would be a fine howl. But there the Venus lies out for anybody to gloat over that wants to. And there she has a right to be, for she is a work of art, and art has its privileges, etc. So, funny. If you've been told that you have to put the smuttiness out of your mind when you look at art, I give you license to look at the Venus of Urbino in a new way. So Giulio Romano gets a commission from the Duke of Mantua to build a pleasure palace. It's one of these country houses that is 3 miles away from town. It's never very far away. And Mantua is situated almost like on a peninsula. It's surrounded by a lake in three directions. There is a little island in a spit of water here with an existing sort of farmhouse. And Giulio's task is to refit the farmhouse, to redecorate the farmhouse in a modern way. So you can see that there is this, in its original condition, not anymore, bridges going to the plot of land onto which the Palazzo Te, or the Palazzo del Te, is situated. And Te just means tea. So it's the Tea Palace. It's where the Duke of Mantua would go to have tea. So this is the original building. And Giulio's first task, his first commission, is to do a series of paintings. Because Giulio is a painter. He primarily comes to architecture through painting. He does a series of rooms, and these are all allegorical themes, the giants, the gods, and so forth. After having done that, he's given the commission to expand the palace and to redecorate the palace. So it's a funny commission, because in its original state, it's just this farmhouse. The windows aren't exactly where you want them to be, but if you're doing wall paintings, you don't exactly care where the windows are. Then when he gets the task of refurbishing the facades, he has to make sense out of these oddly placed windows, which by this point he can't move, because he's already done the paintings on the interior. This is one of the large rooms with this banquet of the gods that Giulio has there. Great stuff. And this is a room that I think is really one of the most interesting. It's the Hall of Giants. And in the Hall of Giants, Giulio is, I think, playing with this idea of the corner in Renaissance architecture. And we've spoken at length about how difficult it is to do a good corner. The column never quite wants to be in the corner. It's always a difficult situation. This is all wall painting. This is not architecture at all. But one of the themes is that these giants are pulling the column out of the corner, and the whole building is collapsing because this impossible column has been pulled away and the ceiling falls down, revealing this pantheon of gods up above. There's another room in the Palazzo del Te called the Hall of Horses. You can kind of see how it works spatially here. It's kind of blank down below, and then up above there are all these kind of wonderful horse portraits, because Gonzaga was a great lover of horses. And in my mind, although not in the mind of Italian friends that I've run this past, but in my mind, and this is actually true, I'm not making this up, the word cavalletto means kind of like window jamb or door jamb or frame. And cavallo means horse, and etto means little. So cavalletto would mean little horse, but cavalletto would also mean window frame. He's substituting a little horse for a little window frame here. And I think this is so brilliant. And I've run this past Italian friends, and they've told me, no, we don't say it like that. It's wrong. But if it were true, it would be such an interesting way of really using language to drive the argument. And I would say it is true. Not that my Italian is better than real Italian's Italian, but it's the word. The word is the same. Cavalletto means frame, and cavalletto means little horse. So why not put up a little horse as a window frame? So the painting's great. Let's look at the palace. Giulio expands this existing building and begins to put a series of support buildings here, a grotto here, and this hemicycle at the end. And what this thing does is it catches the space, but lets your view continue beyond the space. So you get this kind of double reading, and the double reading is containment and extension at the same time. In fact, there are a number of spaces that you encounter here. It's really beautifully sequenced in terms of the different moments you get. You have these various vestibules. You have a courtyard completely bounded and contained by architecture. You pop out into a loggia, where your view is focused toward the garden. A loggia is a covered porch, L-O-G-G-I-A. Here we see a little bridge, and the little bridge is taking us across things called the fish ponds, and then we walk across this greensward, this garden, and we find things at the perimeter. So what's the language of the Palazzo del Te? And you can see from this front elevation that it's a really varied rhythm. And part of the reason that the rhythm is so varied is that Giulio has to accommodate the strange window placings. So instead of simply having a nice, let's say, Bramantian A, or Brunelleschian A, same rhythm, he's already oscillating the rhythm so that there's a kind of widening at the entry. There's every bay is a different dimension, and he negotiates the difference in the bay sizes by playing with where these pilasters go. Here they're kind of far apart, here they're close together, and so there's kind of cleverness going on. The wall is incredibly plastic. He's using different layers within the wall to get these different differences in the geometry to fall into place. He's also using rustication. And by rustication, what do I mean? Lisa. Right. Exactly, the roughening of the materials, the deliberate use of rough stone to show us difference between these different layers. You can know that this layer is different from this layer because the level of rustication is quite different. In the Michelozzo Palazzo Medici in Florence, we saw rustication being used. This layer is one thing, this layer is one thing, this layer is one thing, in a horizontal sense. Here it's a vertical sense, a kind of archaeological sense. You peel away one layer, you find another layer. You pop through the vestibule, and you see your view lined up. You get this skewer, this visual skewer, through all the spaces, right like this. And the vestibule itself is a kind of strange thing. It's a heavily rusticated vestibule, and the columns in the vestibule look like they're made out of Tootsie Rolls. They're really, really rough, and they're really kind of spongy. That is to say, they don't simply have entices, but they get really skinny at the top and skinny at the bottom, so they bulge out in a strange way, as though they're some kind of primitive thing. Walk through, what do you see? Well, now things are looking pretty nice. This is the courtyard that you're in, this little courtyard over here. It's got this beautiful Doric order, colossal Doric order surrounding it, and it's got a series of wonderful little triglyphs over here. And these wonderful little triglyphs that we see, part of the Doric frieze, would make you think that finally Giulio has reined it in. Finally Giulio is becoming a little bit more canonic. But if you look over here, you begin to see that he's doing funny things with the triglyphs. But if you look right over here, you can see things are slipping down. If the triglyph happens to be above a column, it's okay. But for these intermediate triglyphs, they are in crisis. And frequently, Giulio will displace them. Giulio will just slip them down to begin to say, architecture is hard. There's no easy way to balance the tectonic forces in a building. Things fall apart. In fact, it's almost as though that rupture set forth by pulling the column down on the painted wall of his building sets in action this chain reaction of dismantlement that configures the whole building. This is still the same courtyard. These are different stages of renovation. They tend to paint everything white. And so this is what it used to look like before they painted it a very pastel color. It looked better. But look at how the keystone gets used. We saw Michelangelo layering keystone upon keystone upon keystone and shrinking them down and sticking them on pilaster capitals. And here, too, the keystone is not really being used to suggest this is what's holding things together, but it almost looks like this is what's splitting things apart. It's too big, and it's so rusticated, it looks like a thing of the earth. So it's popping up and splitting things apart. And as all of this moving and shaking goes on in terms of the entablature and the keystone, you also notice that there's another layer that's being revealed, this really smooth layer. But this smooth layer undulates. It's kind of wavy. And to me, it looks like he's cladding jello with stone facing. And the stuff underneath this stone facing is wobbling like crazy. And occasionally, when he cuts in these blind windows, you can see the wobble. You can see this kind of protean matter of the earth taking form and becoming something. And the thing that it becomes is antithetical to the cultural constraints and geometrical constraints that architecture wants to put on it. Fabulous. So we pop through the loggia, and we look over here at this little hemicycle down there. And this is from inside the garden, looking back at the exterior garden facade of the building. And that, too, is pretty odd. And you look at this thing, and you see how it transforms before your very eyes between something that is essentially a columnar structure to something that is essentially a wall structure, constantly doubling or switching from pier to column or inserting blind window into pier so that local symmetries obtain at every moment. But in terms of the whole thing, it's really unstable. And in fact, he uses the reflecting pond. We saw in the plan the bridge that goes across the reflecting pond to do a couple of things. In one sense, it's a kind of recreation of the journey across the bridge to get to the island that Palazzo d'Alte is situated on. And on another level, it creates a stability and it creates a symmetry across the horizontal axis. In the real world, symmetry and balance are denied to you, but in reflection, in the virtual world, you can have that kind of stability. Clever. Let's look at another great Mannerist garden, and this is the Villa Lante by Vignola. And Vignola is an interesting guy because he wrote a treatise on architecture which is really dry, really canonic, really formulaic. These are the orders as put forward by Vignola. Ugh. Hate them. And the reason I hate them is that there's none of this madcap stuff that we saw Giulio going on with. And by madcap stuff, I mean, you know, playing with rustication on a column or playing with the proportions of the column to emphasize the meaning. Instead, they're just, you know, there they are. And it's funny that this guy, Mr. Vignola, was able to write this treatise because his architecture is inspired. And it's inspired because of its engagement with the land and its ability to read nature as a force against which architecture is always measuring itself. Here we have the Villa Giulia. The Villa Giulia is situated to the north of Rome. This is the Via Flaminia, one of the big old Roman roads. Here's the Tiber River, and here's the Villa Giulia. So this would have been considered a country house, even though it is, in fact, a three-minute bus ride from the center of Rome right now. But it's not completely a country house. It's maybe, let's say, straddling the line between country and city. And so how does the architect make that manifest? If you look at this thing, you can see that, well, this seems to be about an architectural edge. And as we move in this direction, there seems to be a dissolving of the architectural edge. So maybe here, too, architecture becomes a filter between two different conditions. The architectural edge, the arrival, and the dismantling of the architectural edge. Here's a section. And the section, I think, is pretty interesting because it shows you that Vignola is not simply performing this operation of dissolving the coherence of a palace in plan, but he's also doing it in section. That as you move out, this center gets established through carving down. So many of the same games that we saw at the Belvedere, the idea of ground plane being activated to create different spaces within the scheme, but also to tweak the meaning of the spaces of the scheme. Architecture as frame. You look at this thing, it's got this big old frame around it. You might even say this operation that Vignola is doing. Seems like he's unplugging the villa, that you would kind of imagine that this piece, which is over here, this sunken grotto, could slide in and complete the villa, but instead it's been pulled apart. It's almost as though he's looking at the incomplete state of something like the Villa Madama by Raphael, this hemicycle locked onto a loggia, and appreciating the tensions that are there, and finding a way to actually make that the theme of his architecture. and not just this residual condition left over by accident. Here's what it looks like. So it really seems kind of like a decorous palazzo, right? Oh, we have a very nice center. It's very symmetrical. Let's go in. And just where you expect to find a courtyard, you find this evacuation of courtyard. And the wall that you would expect to bound the space has been pulled out. There are a series of thresholds that you cross as you move through the Villa Giulia, and each one reveals a different condition to you. You also get this variation on a theme as you move through the space. We get this kind of tripartite organization of arch with little arches on the front facade, almost like a triumphal arch. And if we look at the facade of the hemicycle, you get something that also kind of looks like a triumphal arch. And this triumphal arch motif repeats itself in varied forms as we move along the line. Here's what we see on the inside of the hemicycle. It is elaborately painted to look like you're inside some kind of trellis, some kind of garden, that the garden has invaded the architecture. We're moving on down the line. We're seeing the condition of the triumphal arch become increasingly dematerialized as we approach it. From the palazzo side, let's say from the building side, you see something like this, which is essentially a wall that's been perforated. And as you move farther in, you see something that's simply a columnar triumphal arch. This idea of the triumphal arch, this figure of the triumphal arch, doesn't simply happen in elevation, but the same figure that we see in elevation also happens in plan. So there's a kind of flipping in preposterous ways. When we get to the grotto, here's the grotto, we have the same kind of triumphal arch motif now sunk down into that deep sunken space. And the language has really changed even more. It's not simply columnar, but the columns have become animated. They've become these half-human, half-column things called herms, H-E-R-M. And where are they situated? They're situated in water. This is a grotto. It's really spectacular because as you move lower and lower, the climate actually changes from hot, getting beat up by the sun, Rome, to something where you're being splashed with water, you're in the shade, and the natural cooling properties of the earth change. So the making of the grotto provides a real amenity for the garden, this little microclimate within the whole of the system, but it also begins to organize a center against which these transformations can be read. We're pulling things apart, we get ourselves our little grotto, the grotto carves down, and then when we finally come out through another triumphal arch construct, we find ourselves in the ideal paradise garden. The theme of the constant displacement of center that we saw in the Belvedere is also going on here too. The theme of the ground plane, and now a new theme, the theme of water, how water can begin to participate in the argument now. So we will talk about gardens again next time.